Christ Church of Oak Brook, Illinois, presents for your enjoyment, Christmas at Christ Church. The year was 1809, and the air was filled with sound, too, only it wasn't anywhere near as joyful as the music we've just heard. Dinner tables everywhere were abuzz with talk of a French dictator with an apparently insatiable appetite for conquest. The self-proclaimed emperor was so effectively crushing the Austrian people that the newspapers began to question whether any nation could stand up against his armies. That Napoleon would change the continent forever seemed doubtless. And given all of these world-shaking events, it's not that surprising that some other quieter ones passed by unnoticed. Of what consequence, for example, was the birth of mere babies compared to the great columns of soldiers marching relentlessly across the land? Maybe that helps explain why few took much notice when the wife of an obscure minister named Tennyson gave birth to a child named Alfred Lord. It helps us to understand why there was probably little fanfare when to the Holmes family of Cambridge, Massachusetts, a child called Oliver Wendell was born. Nor was the excitement all that widespread when, in that same year, 1809, into the world came children with names like Edgar Allan Poe, William Gladstone, or Charles Darwin. The same year, in fact, when, in a rugged cabin in Hardin County, Kentucky, a baby named Abraham was born of a mother named Lincoln. No, ask any newspaper reporter or politician in 1809, what are the most significant history-altering events that have happened this year? And no doubt they'd respond, why the Napoleonic conflicts, of course. If you were to tell him that it was not really what was happening on the Austrian battlefield, but rather what was happening in the cradles of a few families in England and America that would truly changed the course of politics, law, literature, and science. It's pretty unlikely you'd find your name in print, except as an illustration of how out of touch with reality some people can be. But then it's not always easy to see what matters most, except in hindsight, is it? We can all come to overvalue the wrong things and undervalue the ones that really count. It happens these days, just as it did in 1809, or I might add, as it did long before that. And this music helps to bring us back to that time.
Christmas Day.
If you'd asked someone on the street in Palestine in the year 1 AD, what are the really important things happening right now in the world? What do you think you'd hear? Well, you'd probably be told about the sort of people and events with which Luke's account of Christmas begins. You'd certainly hear about Caesar Augustus, for compared to him, even Napoleon looked like a foot soldier. In the time of Augustus, the Roman legions held sway over some 7 million square miles of territory. The empire stretched from the Atlantic Ocean in the west to the Euphrates River in the east, from the Sahara in the south to the Danube in the north. Throughout this kingdom, the name of Caesar was the name above all names. When Caesar coughed, hundreds of thousands of people caught colds. And as the Bible suggests, in the beginning of the first millennium, Caesar cleared his throat. For years, the tiny country of Palestine had been the Guam of the Roman Empire. It was too tiny to pay much attention to, but too strategically located along trade routes to be discarded completely. Rome had ruled this minute strip of land through the person of Herod the Great, a part Jewish, part Roman governor whose deft political hand kept the populace relatively peaceful. It is hard to keep peace through politics alone, however. The events in our schools and churches and across the world this year have reminded us of that. The truth is that peace of the deepest kind begins not in the halls of power, but in the hearts of people. Hearts that have been touched and transformed by a gift from above. And who can't help but rejoice in the face of that gift? Whether it's within a person's heart, or between individuals, or even among nations, it's difficult to establish a lasting peace through politics alone. Upon the death of Herod the Great, the southern portion of Palestine, known as Judea, fell by bequest to Herod's son, Archelaus. Lacking his father's political savvy, Archelaus governed with such a clumsily cruel hand that Palestine erupted in a series of violent uprisings. In disgust, Caesar Augustus fired Archelaus and transferred the governor of Syria, a man named Publius Quirinius, down to Palestine to take his place. Quirinius's first job as the new governor of Judea was to enforce a tax on the Jewish people, which Caesar hoped would help bring Palestine in line with the rest of the empire. To tax people effectively, of course, you have to have a mechanism for registering their identity and payments. And in a world without a federal mail system, that mechanism was a census. Quirinius required all Jews to return to their place of birth to be counted and to pay the first installment of the new tax. It was thus, says the scripture, that Joseph also went up from the town of Nazareth in Galilee to Judea, to Bethlehem, the town of David, because he belonged to the house and line of David. He went there to register with Mary, who was pledged to be married to him and was expecting a child.
Thank you.
as I've said, if you asked anyone in Palestine at this moment, what current people and events are truly of world-shaping importance? They would almost certainly have said, why, Caesar, Quirinius, and the new tax package. It would be the equivalent today of saying, why Clinton, Bush, and those soaring internet stocks? But what is fascinating is that the Bible doesn't give that answer at all. Oh, it mentions the big names and the political doings, all right. But the weight of Luke's record of that moment in history is on people and events that would never make even the last page of the Jerusalem Times. Let me put it in Luke's own words again. While they were in Bethlehem, the time came for the baby to be born. And Mary gave birth to her firstborn, a son. She wrapped him in swaddling clothes and laid him in a manger, because there was no room for them in the inn. It's funny what turns out to be truly important, truly worth singing about, isn't it? In 1809, it looked like it was the battles being fought in the villages of Austria. Hardly anyone noticed the babies being born to poor families like Lincoln, Tennyson, Holmes, and Poe. Yet now we can't even remember the names of those Austrian towns, while those children have left a legacy we can never forget. At the turn of the first millennium, it looked like history would always revolve around the House of Augustus. Few people had even heard of the House of Common Bread, for that's what the name Bethlehem literally means. No, all the talk was of the emperor. Only a few wild-eyed prophets, whom no one took seriously, spoke of the coming of one who would be the King of Kings. Yet here is the reality now. Today we name our dogs Caesar, while the name of Jesus still inspires men and women to acts of sacrifice and service with a power that even Napoleon once admitted to envying. Toward the end of his life, Bonaparte said, Alexander, Caesar, Charlemagne, and I founded empires, but upon what did we rest the creations of our genius? Upon force. Jesus Christ alone founded his empire upon love, remarked Napoleon. And at this hour, millions would die for him. Napoleon was right, and we dare not forget it in our time. There is no power so influential and enduring as the authority of love. And every time we stop our mad rushing to give our child our full attention or offer forgiveness to someone, every occasion when we dare to say, "Let's start again," to a spouse or a friend from whom we've grown distant, whenever you and I reach out to a stranger or sacrifice to give of our substance to meet the needs of the poor, we do something amazing. We let our lives become conduits of that transforming love that once stooped down from heaven to this earth. As we listen to the bells ring, take just a moment to think of the people who may need you to pour out that kind of power upon them in the year to come. wouldn't it be great if we could know now what matters most, and not later when our hindsight no longer can do us or the world any good? Wouldn't life be richer and more secure if we had some guide for the conduct of all our affairs, so that we valued the truly important things and invested in the relationships and enterprises that will truly last? The Bible says that God's desire is to give us that kind of guidance. He wants to fill your life and mine with the light of His Holy Spirit. That Spirit can enable us to see all the people and the problems and the priorities of our lives in proper perspective. That infilling isn't meant to be merely a Christmas experience. It's not meant to be a blessing that we only tap when we're in some foxhole. God's desire is to fill and refill your life and mine moment by moment. For that to happen, we've got to remain open to Him all the time. And sometimes music helps to open the door of the soul like nothing else can.
A seeker for light in a dark world. I looked for truth, but I settled for lies. I had been blinded, I couldn't see. Till a star in Bethlehem sky opened my eyes. I have seen the light shining in the darkness, bursting through the shadows, delivering the dawn. Oh.
The message of Christmas is that God has given us His light. We have the light of His presence to illumine the darkness. We have the light of His love to warm us in life's shadows. And we have the light of His Word to show us the way. We no longer have to guess at what is truly important. For in the pages of Scripture, you and I find guidance for the use of our time, our talent, even our treasure. We find direct instructions on the way of life that bears the most fruit and the dangers that lie along life's way. We find pictures of the sort of people who will be the biggest change makers, even though the world may not esteem them as such. In the Bible, we find assurance about where history is going, who is making it go there, and who waits for us at the end. Even in the story we read today, we find clues as to how to live in this coming century. And with your permission, I'd like to share just two. First, the Bible invites us to trust God like Mary did. It had to be very difficult for a girl of no more than 16 years of age to believe that the unwanted, unwedded pregnancy she'd been saddled with was not, in fact, a terrible curse, but actually the blessing of God. In like fashion, it has to be difficult for you who may be going through a financial reversal right now, or you have had some character weakness attacked, or you have had to suffer recently a terrible loss or a predicament not of your own making, to believe that these things aren't just a curse, but may actually be places where the providential hand of God can birth something life-changing in you. And yet if, like Mary before you, you will try trusting in the providence of God a little while longer, I believe you may discover what Mary did, that on the other side of the toughest kind of labor, and sometimes only by that route, there often lies a surprising joy.
Yeah.
The Christmas story invites you and me to trust God like Mary did, but also to obey God like Joseph did. Can you imagine how hard it must have been for Joseph to obey God's instruction, to take Mary as his wife even after hearing the news that she was pregnant when he knew it wasn't by him? Many of you can imagine. Some of you know how immensely tough it is to forgive someone who has failed you, or to keep caring for a spouse after you see how flawed that person is. You know how difficult it is to tell the truth, or to live honestly in the workplace, or to give sacrificially when less might do. You know how hard it is to keep doing good to those who persecute you. And yet, if, like Joseph before you, you will persevere in obeying God, I believe you'll discover what Joseph did as well. That though the road to Bethlehem is hard, it is still the path to greater life. Sometimes it takes a childlike faith to perceive that truth. And perhaps the following song will help us to recover that point of view. The words of the old hymn I learned as a child still ring through my mind during difficult days, reminding me of the faith of Mary and Joseph. Trust and obey, for there's no better way. When my faith flags still, when I wonder if I'd be smarter to pursue the way of the Napoleons and the Caesars of this world, when I'm tempted to take what I can and use who I will to build my own private empire, I sometimes remember a vivid scene that keeps me going a different way. For many years at this time, the Metropolitan Museum of Art in New York has displayed the same scene beneath the great Christmas tree. What strikes you as you first approach it are perfectly carved replicas of Roman buildings, each bespeaking the grandeur of what the world deems important and secure. As you draw nearer, however, you notice that the buildings are in ruin. They are cracked and crumbling as everything made by human hands finally does. And yet there among the broken down columns, surrounded by humble creatures that seem oddly perpetual amidst the decay all around, you find the figures of Mary and Joseph, and a babe wrapped in swaddling clothes and lying in a manger. My friends, when all that some think matters most has long since passed away, who will have proved the wiser? The ones who put their faith in the life represented by those cracked columns, or the ones who dared to trust and obey the life that filled that creche? I hope each of us knows. I hope you and I have the capacity to see and to pursue in this new century ahead what truly counts, and then to help others discover this good news.